Welcome to the 43rd Theoretical Physics Colloquium by Professor Midhat Unzal from North Carolina State University. A few words about Midhat. He received his PhD in 2004 at the Institute for Nuclear Theory of Washington University in Seattle. He had several postdoctoral positions at Boston University, at Stanford University and SLAC. So a couple of years at the first place, and then maybe about 4 or 5 years at the other. And then he received a faculty position at San Francisco State University in 2011, where he spent 2 years before moving to North Carolina State University in 2014. He has a wide range of interests. He is well known in studies of quantum field theory, non-perturbative techniques, resurgence theory, trans theories, Pickard-Lefschetz theory in physics, mixed anomalies, mathematical physics, phases of finite temperature, field theories, QCD, supersymmetric gauge dynamics on the lattice and in quantum field theory, classification on non-perturbative settle points, and many, many other things. And today he will be talking about semi-abelian gauge theories, non-invertible symmetries, and string tensions beyond analogy. You could start.
Okay, first of all, thank you very much to Igor. At the first round of the invitation, I was supposed to talk about resurgence, but you know, this subject came up and I thought it wasn't less important than resurgence, and it's very intriguing to my mind. So I asked him to change the topic, and he kindly agreed to do that. So the title of my talk has some unknown words, semi-abelian gauge theory. That's a definition that I will give. And non-invertible symmetry, which starts to emerge in the broad area of quantum field theory fairly recently. And I will use these things to explain some interesting things about string tensions, in particular string tension beyond analogy. And this is the work done by two excellent colleagues, Mendel Nguyen, my student, and Yuya Tanizaki from Yukawa Institute. Okay, so to begin with, let me give some motivation. Also, please feel free to ask questions anytime you want. So here is the motivation. We know a handful of theories, maybe 3-4 of them, in which in 3 or 4 dimensions, where confinement and mass gap generation can be understood analytically. These are Poryakov model, it's a time unearthed model, Seibert-Witten theory on R4, and QCD adjoint on R3 cross S1, which is again solvable. And Deform-Yang-Mills theory is again on R3 cross S1. So a common feature of all these theories in which we can show mass gap and confinement is that as you go to long distances, SUN gauge structure reduces to maximal abelian subgroup, U1 to N-1. This is due to Higgsing by adjoint Higgs field in the game, which is algebra valued, or due to gauge holonomy in the case of the theories on R3 process one. Another common feature of all of these theories is that there is always an SN permutation group, which lives actually in SUN structure. And this is the Weyl group of SUN. And in all of these examples, this SN group is Higgsed. So the Higgsing of SN pervades the physics of these systems. And to the people people who are more interested in Yang-Mills theory, they may see them very distinct from pure Yang-Mills. Okay, and they are. Now, this manifests itself in the spectrum. For example, if you look to the spectrum of the fundamental string tensions, either in Seibert-Witten theory or Poryakov model, instead of one fundamental string of in pure Yang-Mills theory, at that level, you see N-1 fundamental strings, and these are all different tension. This is an implication of spontaneously broken SN, okay, Higgsing of SN. If you look to the glue ball masses, instead of one glue ball that we expect in pure Yang-Mills theory, you see n minus one distinct dual photons because you reduce the theory to maximal abelian group, and there are n minus one photons in the game, and each one of them acquires a different mass. This splitting to n minus one is an imprint of broken permutation symmetry. Okay. Now, also it's worth mentioning that the string tensions are not dictated by enality, center symmetry. They are dictated by charges on the weight lattice of whatever probe you are using. And these features are sometimes represented as deficiency of these models. And to my mind, they are not deficiency. They are just feature of these theories, okay? Aspects of these theories. Now, however, I want to mention also an interesting aspect of pure Yang-Mills theory, okay? So if you take Yang-Mills theory or QCD with adjoint matter, usually the string tensions are dictated by enality. So if you probe it with fundamental quark, which has enality one, it has particular tension. And if you probe it with some anti-symmetric or symmetric quark, it has a different tension, et cetera, et cetera. And formally speaking, this is true. But however, the true story, the real story is actually more interesting. Let me take a probe here, some fermion in some representation R, and its conjugate representation. And let me plot here, instead of potential, the derivative of the potential with respect to R, you know, formally like a force, okay? And at short distances, of course, we know that all non-abelian gauge theories exhibit Coulomb potential. So there is a one over R potential. And this is representation dependent. And at asymptotically large distances, we know that there is a string tension which is dictated by enality. However, in these theories, there is some intermediate regime in which tension looks like it is dependent on representation. Okay. And there is actually two interesting scales in the problem. One of them is the strong length scale of the theory, and the other one is something related to strong length scale, also involves n for the SUN. And the fact that, you know, string tension has such a feature is actually observed in a number of lattice simulations, primarily the ones by Bali, de Forcran, and others, okay? But this is not sufficiently widely appreciated. Okay. Okay. Let me give a little bit more detail on this picture. If you take your probes to be fundamental or fundamental cross fundamental, et cetera, et cetera, this cascade that I mentioned here does not exist. Okay. You have Coulomb's law and you have asymptotic string tension. And if you take your probe to be adjoint, then there is actually an intermediate regime where there is a formation of the flux tube, but ultimately this flux tube snaps and you end up with zero string tension, okay? This is also incidentally the structure that we see QCD with fundamental fermions. There is such an intermediate regime, and at long distances, we would think that there is no linear confinement. And if you look to more generic representation in pure Yang-Mills theory, take product of n fundamental and m fundamental bar, then there are these three regimes and there is this cascade, okay? And the question I would like to pose is the following: why does this intermediate regime exist, representation dependent tension exist? And does it have anything to do with the story I told you earlier about these dynamically abelianizing models, okay? And interestingly, I will suggest that there is actually a very non-obvious symmetry in pure Yang-Mills theory. This is a suggestion. In some theories, we are sure that it exists. But in pure Yang-Mills theory, I will suggest that there is a there is a non-obvious symmetry which will explain this behavior of the string tension. Okay. Now, let me now define what I mean by semi-abelian theory. It is a made-up word, and you will see the reason why it may be interesting. First of all, there are two theories that I will play as interesting models. One of them is abelian theory, U1 to n minus one, with global non-abelian discrete symmetry, Sn. This Sn is actually quite unusual because in pure gauge theories, usually we do not have non-abelian global symmetries. We always have abelian global symmetries. Then I will do something interesting. I will gauge this Sn, and the theory will turn to a semi-direct product of these continuous parts with the non-abelian discrete parts, and they are entwined with each other. So it is really a semi-direct product. Okay. So a formal way to think about this is really coupling this to something called topological quantum field theory, but it doesn't really matter for now. Now, here is the interesting thing. So in all the theories I mentioned you earlier, Polyakov model, Seibert-Witten, as well as QCD adjoint on R3 cross S1, I mentioned that the counterpart of this Sn is part of the gauge structure. And in all of these models, it is Higgs. On the other hand, if you go to pure Yang-Mills theory, like you know, Sun Yang-Mills theory, there is every reason to believe that this Sn is not Higgs at all. And we wanted to construct something in between and something understandable. This is, of course, famously hard. And these theories are very nice and welcoming, and we understand a great deal about them, but they have this feature very unlike, pure Yang-Mills theory. So I will construct this class of theories, which is a semi-direct product of U1 to n minus one with Sn. And in these theories, it will turn out that this Sn global symmetry is not fixed. And it will also turn out that many properties of the semi-abelian theory are much closer to pure Yang-Mills theory than all these dynamically abelianizing theories.
Mithat, can I ask a quick question?
Yes, please.
The Higgsing of Sn in these theories is not associated with a phase transition. Is that right?
No, it's not. Okay. There is no gauge invariant order parameters, for example, in the form Yang-Mills that can distinguish small circle confined phase on R3 cross S1 from the large circle confined phase. They are in the same universality, and most of their properties are extremely similar. Now, I will, much more concrete, I will work with some three-dimensional gauge theory, lattice gauge theory, but it doesn't really matter. I will work with both Wilson formulation as well as Lane formulation of the lattice gauge theory. These are equivalent at weak coupling, and both of these things capture the non-perturbative dynamics quite precisely. And it will turn out that Lane form is very convenient for doing exact dualities. You can derive many interesting exact dualities, and Wilson type formulation is better for gauging of the Sn. So we will work with both and illustrate some of these general ideas that I mentioned. And I just, to set up the talk, I need to say one thing about the notation. We will work on a lattice, and there will be a lambda three is my original lattice, and there will be a dual lattice. Lattice is composed of R cells. This is sites, links, plaquettes and cubes, and dual lattice. Duality is defined by this star operation. If you have a R cell, it maps to D minus R cell. So dual of the site is a cube, dual of a link is a plaquette, so and so forth. I think intuitively, this is a clear picture. Even if you do not know technicalities, it doesn't matter. Here is the Wilson formulation. So You start
Excuse me, may I ask a quick question? Yes, so lattice is crucial. Can you go to continuous limit at least at the very end of the story, or it's not possible?
2+1 lattice gauge theory, this abelian or the semi-abelian theory, has different continuum limits depending on how you take the limit. This is sort of same classification in the classic paper of Mack and Gopfert. You can take a limit in which mass gap is finite, but the tension blows up. It's a little bit sick in that regard. There's also a limit in which there's a Coulomb phase emerging. So I will look at this system as an interesting lattice field theory system. And I will tell you my motivation for looking at it from a continuum field theory point of view.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Nice question. Now, of course, Wilson action is written in the first term. There are n photons here in the game, but there is a Lagrange multiplier which constrains these photons. The sum of them is strictly zero, modulo 2 pi. And F is my field strength curvature. And the constraint tell me that there are really n minus one photons that are physical. The constraint, And one thing that is very manifest in this Wilson formulation that also I also like is that you see that there are n indices for the photons, and the global SN permutation symmetry is essentially shuffling of these indices. And the symmetry is obviously manifest in the Wilson formulation, which is very nice and very easy, you know, doesn't matter. And as I said, this is really, this is a simple observation, but this is really the first example that I know of a pure gauge theory, either abelian or non-abelian, that is possessed with some non-abelian global symmetry. Now, there is an equivalent formulation, which is called Villain formulation. F is my field strength, and gauge field is valued in, let's start with R to N minus one. And this NP is fields associated with the faces, plaquettes. You can really think of this, if you write this down, so this MP is something on the root lattice. If you write this down, you will see that it has a usual zero form gauge invariance and one form gauge invariance associated with transformation of the link field with some link valued gauge transformation. And since the quotient of R to N minus one with root lattice is U1 to N minus one, this also defines nicely you want the n minus one lattice gauge theory, okay? And my partition function is given by integration over all gauge fields and summation over all plaquette fields. And these two things are exactly equivalent at big coupling. Yeah. I want to say something very formal about global symmetries. And this is this is some improvement on our older understanding of global symmetries, okay? Recently in this work of Gaiotti et al, symmetry is defined as the existence of some topological generator. First of all, instead of zero form symmetry, we learned that we are, there are p-form symmetries. We already knew this, but the thing we did not quite know, for example, we know already knew that center symmetry was a one-form symmetry, not the usual symmetry. The thing we did not know was that there are these topological operators associated with these manifolds. M is space-time dimension minus P for the P-form minus one. So let me give you a textbook example. So for example, if you have a conserved current, you know, by Noether theorem, we can define a charge, which is an integral over space. But in Euclidean space, we can immediately generalize this. Instead of taking space, we can take any D minus one dimensional manifold and construct star of J. And this is a charge defined on E minus one manifold. And you can define this object U sub alpha M D minus one, which is a generator of this symmetry. What this means is following. So if you act with this generator on some local operator, it implements symmetry transformation, symmetry action on these charged operators. So, and this relation is topological in the following sense. It doesn't really matter where you put this sphere here. As long as this point is inside, it doesn't really matter. This is the relation. So similarly, if you have a P equal one form symmetry, then this will act on line operators, for example, Wilson lines. And the symmetry will be generated by codimension two defects, something surrounding the line. So it will act on the Wilson loop in representation R by a transformation exponential to pi I divided by n R. This magnitude of R, I used it in my notation as the enality. And this gives us a nice explanation of the enality rule. For example, if you have a joint, it doesn't transform. If you have fundamental, it transforms, and you expect some structure coming from there. This is a formal discussion, and it turns out that it is somehow useful. Okay. Now, for the theory at hand, I have a very large one form symmetry. Actually, I have this link field, and I can do this link transformation. This is, you can think of them almost like a global transformation, you know, transforming all the links in one direction by the same angle, all the links in the other direction by the same angle. This is something very well known in the lattice gauge theory community. And this is actually a global symmetry. And as I said, there is also discrete non-abelian zero form symmetry. And I told you that it was very easy to describe in the Wilson formulation, and in Wilhelm formulation, it's a little bit harder. You have to take these, your gauge field to something by this transformation. This transformation is really something that lives in the Weyl group of SUN. As long as you do that, it is a non-trivial transformation. But since we have already seen that it is a nice global symmetry by using Wilson formulation, we don't have to worry about this technicality. So the punchline is the purely abelian theory has two global symmetries. One of them is Sn semidirect with Z2. This Z2 is charge conjugation, Sn is Weyl permutation. And there is this one form global symmetry. This is really a global symmetry, which is U1 to n minus one, okay? So if you do not recall Weyl reflection, for example, if you take mu1 here and do a Weyl reflection with respect to alpha one, there is this standard formula. You do a, this is a technical point. I can skip that, okay? It's not important. Now, how do these symmetries act on observables? Let us take Wilson lines. In the semi-abelian, in the abelian theory, this omega is some charge, and the invariance under one form symmetry tells us that omega must be in the weight lattice of the SUM. You see, there is an intimate relation between this abelian theory that I constructed and SUM theory. You can think of it as a theory that lives in the Cartan torus of the SUN theory. Because of this, SUN representation and SUN language will come very handy in many points of this discussion. Now, as I said, there is a transformation under this zero form symmetry. It takes these charges and shuffles them, permutes them. For example, it can take this mu1 charge to mu1 minus alpha 1 or mu1 minus alpha 1 minus alpha 2. This is the action of this permutation symmetry. And if you act on Wilson lines associated with this charge, it changes them by this phase. if you have a non-contractible loop, something like Polyakov loop, it will multiply the Polyakov loop by an overall phase, which is a global symmetry. For example, in pure Yang-Mills theory, it will multiply Polyakov loop by a root of unity. But if you have something like a contractible loop, like Wilson loop on, you know, in non-compact space, it will be, its action on it will be trivial. Now, I said that Villain form can be dualized. Actually, there are two steps to do that. And maybe, and you can turn it to a ferromagnet. It is a Zn to the minus one ferromagnet. And you can also turn it to magnetic Coulomb gas. Since this magnetic Coulomb gas is a much better known picture, let me repeat that. So to be on the same line with all friends, okay? So actually you can map this system. I told you that NP are some Plaquette fields. So you can actually do a sum over oriented Plaquette fields surrounding on a cube, for example. And this will give you magnetic flux. And magnetic flux is on the root lattice, okay? And this is the magnetic charge of something living in there. So in this system, in our abelian theory or semi-abelian theory, there are magnetic monopoles and magnetic charges. And the magnetic charges are valued on the root lattice, okay? Now, at this stage, it looks very much like Polyakov model, but just bear with me 1 minute and you will be quite surprised. So this sigma that I defined here is something called dual photon. It is the same content as our original n minus one photon, but because in 2+1 dimension, we can map them by abelian duality to scalars, you know, in 2+1 dimension, photon has one polarization and one degree of freedom, and you can accommodate it inside a scalar. So if you integrate out that dual photon, you reach to an exact Coulomb gas representation. It turns out you can write your partition function. This is a formula that I think all of us would associate something. There are these magnetic charges. Charges are on the root lattice at x tilde prime. These are sides of the dual lattice, and there is some interaction between them, and we are summing over all possible charges. This is like grand canonical ensemble of all possible charges. And if you look to the Euclidean vacuum of this theory, you will see that it's a proliferation of the monopoles. And so far, it sounds almost verbatim with the Polyakov model as well as deformed Yang-Mills. But we know that in both Polyakov model as well as deformed Yang-Mills, this Sn permutation symmetry is Higgs. And if you write down, here's the interesting point. If you write down the effective field theory associated with this model, it turns out that instead of doing a sum over only simple roots that I have written down here, you need to do a sum over all roots of the SUN algebra. So this alpha can be any charge in the SUN, adjoint of the SUN. Because at the end of the day, even if you start with alpha one, the permutation will fill the whole SN orbit, and the whole SN orbit is really the adjoint representation of SUN. Now, this has immediate non-trivial implication. First, remember about Polyakov model. All the monopoles were hierarchical. The first n minus one monopoles have some low action. There is a second layer of monopoles, 2 times the action, third layer of monopoles, 3 times the action, so on and so forth. Now, all of these layers collapse to a single layer. All n square minus n monopoles have precisely the same action. Okay. This is something very interesting because of the following reason. If you go to back to Polyakov model, as I said, there are n minus one photons, and the masses of all of these n minus photons, n minus one photons, are strictly distinct. I think in Polyakov model, it is impossible to make them equal, whatever you do with your Higgs wave.
It's possible if you have SU2 group. For SU2, it's...
But in SU2, there's only one more. One photon. You are. Okay. And for the string tension, there are really n minus one tensions, all different. But in R, you want the n minus one Lattice gauge theory with this SN permutation group. You only have one gap, and it has n minus one fold degeneracy. And all of these tensions are equal. And these are the imprints of unbroken permutation symmetry. And this n minus one is actually standard representation of the SN. If you look to the character table of SN, you will see this n minus one smiling to your face saying that I am here.
Mithat, can I ask a question again?
Yes, please. Yes.
When you say there are n minus one dual photon masses and so on, do you really mean n minus one over two roughly? Because there's charge conjugation symmetry too.
Yeah. So. There is order n, let's say. There are n minus one over two, roughly speaking. Alexei is an expert on this, so yeah, n minus one over two. Correct. Now, let me say a few things about Wilson loops and string tensions. So as I said, we can take any charge, electric charge on the weight lattice. We can construct a loop, Wilson loop. We can write it as a line integral. If you like, you can use Stokes theorem, write it as a surface integral. And if you are fluent with some, you know, minor amount of topology, you can even write this as a volume integral by defining something called Poincaré dual. This D is the Poincaré dual, and this D star P is some sort of bump function, which tells you that this thing is one inside this plaquette, inside this loop, but zero otherwise, okay? Now, this is the standard way of writing the Wilson loop. And in the dual formulation, actually, Wilson loop is slightly more non-trivial to describe. It actually, in the dual photon formulation, this Wilson loop is realized as a defect operator. And what it means is following. Delete this loop and restrict your PET integral to configurations such that the monodromy of this dual photon around this S1 circle is an element of the weight lattice, okay? And this is again, maybe slightly technical discussion, but a useful discussion. So if you want to calculate the expectation value of the Wilson loop, you can calculate it fairly easily. It obeys area law of confinement and the tensions, string tensions are zero. And it is well known since Polyakov that this calculation, this monodromy here can be mapped to a discontinuity at the interface. But since you know, we can take this loop to be filling XY plane, so the calculation of this string tension maps to a very easy problem in quantum mechanics. All you need to do is to calculate the action of some instanton in quantum mechanics, okay? So, and this gives you some tensions. For example, if you take charges mu one, two mu one, mu two, you know, or alpha, which are charges on the weight lattice, the tension of all of these things are given here with some reasonable ansatz. The important point is following. There is no charge in the root lattice for which the tension vanishes, okay? And this simple fact will be very important in our story. So there is nothing, no charge for which the tension is zero, asymptotically. Now, so far, so good. What we did is we discovered some properties of this abelian theory with non-abelian global non-abelian discrete symmetry. It's all very nice. Now comes one of the main points of the talk, okay? Now, as I said, some properties about the tension as well as some properties about the mass spectrum resembles to pure Yang-Mills theory much more than, for example, Cyber-Fitton or Polyakov models. There is no doubt that this is true. But global symmetries are different compared to Yang-Mills. If you take U1 to n minus 1 with global Sn, you know, there is this Sn permutation and one form center. On the other hand, in pure Yang-Mills, I said this Sn was part of gauge structure. There is Z2 charge conjugation, and the center symmetry is not U1 to n minus 1, but it is Zn one form symmetry. But look now what happens when you gauge this Sn and construct this semi-abelian theory. Then zero form symmetry will be same as pure Yang-Mills, and one form symmetry will be same as pure Yang-Mills. So in the sense of global symmetries, for example, if you are doing this 3D model, the global symmetries are same as 3D pure Yang-Mills theory, okay? Yeah, I hope this point is clear. It will be important. And now, let me describe for you what-
May I quickly ask a question? Of course. What prevents you to do from doing the same thing in four dimensions?
Nothing.
Without any lattice.
On the
lattice. Without lattice, what prevents you? Okay, you have still, you can still implement this SN group, right?
Yes, exactly.
You take N U1 theories, and then these are all abelian, but then this permutation theory you can impose by something, by some mechanism, maybe indeed topological field theory or something, and then all these properties are still there. What prevents you?
Nothing prevents us. It is work in progress, actually. And it's an interesting question. Of course, four-dimensional theories, But now this is the structure. Okay, so let us start with Wilson formulation and gauge this permutation symmetry. And this amounts to do the following. You know, we can view elements of U1 to n minus 1 semi-direct SN inside SUN. As follows. So let us define this C field as something living in the Cartan torus of SUN. And this P field is some discrete link field, okay? And this P field is n by n matrix representation of these Weyl reflections. And if you take, this is the way that I denote these link fields. And if you take the product of these two link fields, there's a part which is again a permutation, and there is a part which lives in the U1 to n minus 1, but some things did get shuffled here, okay? And this tells you that this is a semi-direct product structure, and your lattice gauge theory can be written as this part, which is the continuous part and including some part of the discrete group, as well as purely non-abelian discrete parts, okay? At this stage, this is U1 to n minus 1 SN, semi-direct SN gauge theory. Now, if we want to gauge only SN and do nothing to the theory, what we can do is take beta 2 to infinity limit. What this does is something interesting. It imposes local flatness condition on SN gauge fields. Physically, what it means the following. If beta 2 is finite, there are monopoles here associated purely with Sn, okay? And you want to energetically forbid them because the only thing you want to do is gauging of Sn. You do not want to introduce extra degree of freedom in your quantum field theory. And locally, the product, there is this local flatness condition. And this tells you that this SN gauge fields become topological in the limit beta 2 goes to infinity. And you gauge, at the same time, you are able to gauge this SN symmetry. Now, As long as your correlators do not involve non-contractible cycles on some tree manifold, local dynamics of this theory is same as the abelian model. For example, take T3. This is a manifold in which you can really probe that there is a non-trivial TQFT. But take an open ball inside T3, make it arbitrarily large, take correlators of two operators, and insert an SN-Wilson line in between the two. And this construction, TQFT construction, tells us that we can actually calculate this kind of observables in the abelian theory. Okay. These are globally different theories, but correlators involving non-contractible cycles, if you are dealing with correlators which do not involve non-contractible cycles, they are, they do not care about this thing. And the ones involving non-contractible cycles, they see that there's a TQFT, but locally nothing changes. Okay. Now, let me say few things about the Wilson loops in the original theory. So in the original theory, you can put any charge. For example, if you think this is like SU3 fundamental representation, you can put a charge with, associated with mu1, mu1 minus alpha 1, mu1 minus alpha 1 minus alpha 2. Call them W1, W2, W3. And if you look to, for example, Cyber-Kitten or Polyakov literature, these are the things that are canonically calculated. You can also write down generators of the one form you want the n minus one symmetry transformation. These are the generators which tells you that, okay, these are the generators. Generators act on the Wilson lines and it gives us a phase and Wilson line itself. This is like an eigenvalue equation, but Wilson line is like eigenfunction, if you wish, and topological generator is like an operator, okay? So this is really an eigenvalue equation. It tells you that Wilson line transforms non-trivially under this symmetry generator, okay? But this is all in the you want the n minus one model. What happens when you gauge Sn? So gauging Sn means that none of these operators by themselves are gauge invariants, okay? Neither Wilson operators nor topological generators are gauge invariants. So one must symmetrize Wilson loops and topological operators to build gauge invariant objects. For example, this is fairly easy to see in this semi-abelian theory, the sum over Wilson loop, W1 plus W2 plus all the way Wn is invariant under Sn permutation. Okay. Now, as I said, if you gauge Sn, the most dramatic change is the fact that center symmetry reduces to Zn. And indeed, you can write the Zn generators. They are given in this form. Whatever they are is not that important. And this N label is the group label. And if you take two generators, UN and UM, their fusion obeys the usual group law. It tells us that ZN is a one-form symmetry which is associated with the group ZN, okay? Now comes the interesting part of the story. If you decoupled for a moment, this is the moment to turn back. As I said, under center symmetry, fundamental Wilson loop transformed by a phase, okay? I have depicted a cartoon here. This is my topological line, topological surface. It doesn't matter, this is Wilson loop, and here is your phase. And if you act with the topological operator on adjoint, it is trivial. Here's the punchline. Question is, in this theory, we have a Zn center symmetry. Does it control the string tensions? The answer is no. The reason is, we have already seen that fundamental string tension was zero. This is not surprising, but the tension associated with the adjoint representation is also non-zero. I'm sorry, both of them are non-zero. Despite the fact that this thing associated with adjoint has zero annulment, okay? At the same time, I can also take two analyte, two probes, you know, two mu one, also mu two, and they have the same analyte but different tensions. Okay, so there are infinitely many string tensions in the game instead of just n. And here is the puzzle. How is the presence of infinitely many string tensions compatible with finite center symmetry? It cannot be unless there is further structure in your theory. Okay. And here comes the hero of the story, these non-invertible topological lines. Okay. We need to explain the failure of this analyte rule. Okay. Because if it was up to that, you know, we would only have n types of string tensions, but we have infinitely many. And it turns out in this theory, there is something I will call non-invertible topological symmetry. And it is a generalization of one form center symmetry. And it can be obtained easily as follows. Previously, I defined in the abelian theory, this object here, which was some center generator. And if I x with it, with all elements of the permutation group, I am symmetrizing it at the ultimate way possible. And this object here that I constructed is manifestly invariant under permutation group. The interesting, and this thing satisfies all the features of the one-form symmetry, and it's also topological. Except that if you take this operator, T of theta, and fuse it with T of theta prime, you do not get T of theta plus theta prime. So this, there is no group multiplication law here. This is interesting, okay? Now, if you take your Wilson loop that corresponds to some generic electric charge, okay, Wilson loop, you can symmetrize it by using this permutation. You can write this kind of eigenvalue equation. Your Wilson loop is like eigenfunction, and this topological operator is the operator, and lambda is eigenvalue. And eigenvalues for general representation is of this form. For example, if you act on the fundamental, you obtain this non-trivial eigenvalue for this structure, okay? And I must mention that this kind of non-invertible symmetry operations are sort of, people started to understand them in some two-dimensional quantum field theories, but more on the mathematical language. And there is some work about them, but there is, up to my knowledge, there was no generalization of this to three and four dimensions. And I think that it is immensely important to understand QCD with fundamental or Young-Mills theory ultimately. Okay. Now, okay. How do we, this is the fundamental representation, okay? Now let us go to some analyte zero representation like adjoint. Now the adjoint representation is trivial under center symmetry. You know, center generator acting on it will give you one. But if you act with this non-invertible symmetry, it gives you a non-trivial eigenvalue. And this is the characterization of string tension beyond analyte. The fact that this operator has a non-trivial eigenvalue. And this operation is a one-form symmetry, but as I said, it does not have an inverse. In particular, if you look to this eigenvalue, if you take theta to minus theta, it is the same. It's an even function. And T of minus theta is T of theta. And the fusion rule of this symmetry generator does not obey group law, okay? And for example, if you take two analyte two representations, okay? Something like symmetric and anti-symmetric. Anti-symmetric has one eigenvalue, anti-symmetric has an eigenvalue, and the difference between symmetric and anti-symmetric is another eigenvalue. And this is consistent with our earlier observation with the semi-classics, where I described things in terms of monopole gas, where we saw that tension associated with mu 2 was not equal to tension of associated with 2 mu 1. Now, let us make things more interesting. This semi-abelian theory does not have any electric charges in it. And so what happens if we add something like W bosons, electric charge of W bosons, which is charged under root lattice? Clearly, for the W adjoint, we must have some perimeter law, okay? Because ultimately, this is a breakable string, okay? So if you look at this eigenvalue equation, this equation is only satisfied when theta equals zero. But if theta equals zero, then the symmetry becomes trivial. So if you add adjoint representation to the game as dynamical matter, this symmetry breaks explicitly, okay? But let us say you made either, for example, as an example, you make W bosons heavy, then there will be a domain in which string tension will be controlled by representation. And ultimately, depending on W boson mass and other things in the game, like N, there will be an analyte dependent domain. And this will be the picture of potential between two test quarks as a function of separation. And I hope you appreciate that this is quite curious. This is actually the same picture I have shown you in pure Yang-Mills theory. So now, very interesting. That means I went a bit too fast. Let me make some conclusion. Before that, let me make some conclusion, okay? So we realize that the theories which dynamically abelianize and their dynamics is extremely different from semi-abelian dynamics, okay? For example, as I said, Polyakov model, Seiberg-Witten theory, QCD adjoint, and deformed Yang-Mills have all these imprints of broken permutation symmetry, and semi-abelian, the abelian theory with global symmetry is very nice in this respect, and much more similar to pure Yang-Mills. And if we gauge SN, it becomes far more similar to pure Yang-Mills, okay? And it is very likely that this non-invertible symmetry is also present in pure Yang-Mills theory as an approximate symmetry. But I believe in 3 and 4 dimensions. I believe that if we take, for example, large N limits, the whole set of string tensions is characterized by this non-invertible symmetry rather than center symmetry. It is a strong claim. I say that in the large N limit of Yang-Mills theory, the usual center symmetry has no role whatsoever. Okay, all the tensions are dictated by this non-invertible symmetry. Easiest example of this is adjoint representation. Take an adjoint representation, expectation value of the Wilson loop. You see that at large N, by large N factorization, it factorizes, and the adjoint tension is 2 times fundamental tension. It is not zero. It tells you that Zn center symmetry, even n becoming infinity, does not have any bearing in the large N gauge theory. There is a different structure. And I think that this different structure is the non-invertible symmetry. And finally, this is to my mind, probably the most interesting aspect of this construction. This non-invertible symmetry can very likely provide a meaning to confinement in theories like QCD with fundamental or QCD with anti-symmetric representation. Also, it can provide a meaning to confinement to gauge theories which do not have any center symmetry, like, for example, exceptional groups like G2. Okay. And I already emphasized, it also gives a meaning to the confinement of the adjoint probes in theories like pure Yang Mills. Ah, very good. I think I went more or less on time, but I realized a little bit too fast, but I am open to all the questions.
Okay, thank you very much. We have a couple of raised hands, so let's start with Misha Schiffman.
I want to, it's more a comment than a question, but maybe a question too. I realized why my remark about passing to 4D probably was not quite relevant, because in 3D compact U1 boson confines Aliapov, right? And all you have to do is to symmetrize the theory, okay? In four dimensions, a compact U1 boson doesn't confine. But instead, it's a part of the comment is more like a question. Let's assume that instead you start from SU2N group, and instead replace it by N SU2 groups in 4D. Okay? SU2 group can be made symmetrized. You have to symmetrize them dynamically over all these SU2 groups, right? Like substituting your SUN. SU2, you still can have in 4D, you still can make confining, right? For instance, on a cylinder it confines, or in some other way it confines. And then because you symmetrize all inside SU2, two Higgs bosons have the same mass, but and after symmetrization over all this N SU2s, you will have two N gauge bosons of the same mass. So this center-like symmetry is still there. And it's a confining theory in 4D. What's wrong with it?
Let me first make a comment about the first part, abelian part. Indeed, if you look to lattice QED 3, it has a weak coupling. It has a Coulomb phase. But the way I was thinking about this semi-abelian construction in 4D was similar to construction of the two-hoofed maximal abelian gauge. Instead of constructing two-hoofed maximal abelian gauge, one can construct something like semi-abelian gauge. And in that construction, the monopoles will be light. The problem in the lattice QED in four dimension is the fact that monopoles are super heavy in the weak coupling regime. That's the reason it doesn't lead to confinement. But if we study, for example, SUN gauge theory in some analog of two-hoofed maximal abelian gauge, where we also implement this permutation symmetry, I believe that this idea will work in four dimensions.
No, but why do you need lattice? That's the whole point. If you know
For what I said, I do not need lattice. For the two-hoofed maximal abelian gauge construction of the Yang-Mills, I do not need lattice. I can do it.
Yeah, but it doesn't work. You see, the two-hoofed construction.
No. We believe that, in the two-hoofed maximal abelian gauge, there is confinement, right? It is you reduce to your maximal torus. But there are super light, almost massless monopoles sourced by that, because you are working in that gauge, and their condensation may lead to confinement.
No, but you don't want to have gauge and wire, gauge ambiguity. This construction is artificial, right? Because it opposes the idealization of the theory, but this is not a gauge, unlike, let's say, through Higgsing, it's a different story. It's a gauge invariant construction, but the top construction always, you know, it's up in the air, it scans in the air.
I think there may be a different characterization of this non-inversible symmetry, which is dependent on representation in terms of some surface operators. But I do not fully understand that, you know. So even remaining within the non-abelian theory, but there are some words about it, and I do not want to say words that I do not understand. But I think there is some realistic optimism that one can do something interesting about it. But reducing to products of SU2 is also fine, and this symmetrization. But still, we need to understand SU2 by itself.
Okay, let's give a chance to. Let's give a chance first to Alexei, Chairman. He wanted to ask a question, and then we can return back to this if you'd like.
I think my question is pretty quick. So Mitat, I'd like to understand better your remarks about confinement and the conclusion. But I think I understand what you're hoping for at large n, for the fundamental, QCD fundamental. But it seems like large n is a critical ingredient for this, because only in the large n limit can you hope to have a parametrically large regime where you have these exotic dependence of string tensions on representation. What are you going to do in G2? What is the dream in G2? There's no large n limit.
G2 is interesting. You know, even in G2, okay, it took a lot of time for our lattice friends to see that the string actually snaps. There is a quite beautiful work by Andreas Witt and his friends in lattice gauge theory. And this second scale, despite n being small, is very clearly there. For some reason, okay, this regime, representation dependent regime, is there even for finite n. Actually, if you ask many lattice people, and there are some experts in the audience, Mike Kreutz was in the audience, you know, even for QCD with fundamental, you know, if you put this on the lattice, it takes a lot of effort to see, it took a lot of effort to see this snapping of the string, okay?
I'm happy to grant that, like, that there might be some hand wavy sense in which there is something like this, yeah. But if you want it to be sharp, it seems like you need a large n limit.
Yeah, this second scale here.
It needs to be parametrically separated, otherwise, you're talking.
I can tell you, it is lambda inverse, it is your yardstick, and there is a logarithm of n. Now, you would think that logarithm of n, even if n is large, is fairly small number sometimes. But yeah, that is your parametric separation. The second scale in Yang-Mills theory is really that scale.
I see. Mm-hmm.
And awesome. This is not terrible if 10 is 20 or something like that, but yeah, still.
Okay, did that answer your question, Alexei?
Yes.
Okay, Misha, if you'd like to continue, I just had to interrupt because Alexei was in a rush.
Just one remark, you know.
There was one more question, actually.
Yeah, still returning to SU2, you know, in four dimensions with no lattice, no numerical calculations. For SU2, do you remember from which words you started your presentation today? You said that SUN is not a good theory because even if you consider it, okay, it's bad and good, but if you consider a cylinder, it gives rise to an fully abelianized theory, which can be analytically sort of continued without phase transition to 2R4. Okay, so it's good, but the bad feature that it's all Higgs gauge bosons are different in mass, and there are many different tensions, not a single tension. So basically, you cannot consider, if you want good, relatively good phenomenology, you can only consider it two, right? So take SU2 repeated n times.
Right.
N SU2s, okay? And symmetrize using your trick, symmetrize with regards to this SU2. You will get, in a sense, large N theory, which can also be treated on a cylinder, which has no phase transition from confining phase in the cylinder on the cylinder to confining phase on R4. And yet it has all good features, because it will have all tensions are the same through symmetrization, right? All gauge boson masses are the same. So the string tension somehow should depend on reality. So I think it's a good example of.
I think it may work. Yeah, I agree with you. Yeah, it may work. I agree.
Okay, that's all I wanted to say.
Yes. Now I see what you're saying. It may work, yes.
Maybe you can invoke young people and they can quickly look through. Maybe it's a suggestion. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Very interesting idea. How to make life a little better than it is now.
I'm happy for that.
Okay, let's see. Are there any other questions from the rest of the audience? We don't want to leave anything unresolved before we end this. I don't see any other questions. Sort of a quick question that I had. Oh, actually, sorry, there is another question. Hong Yi, go ahead.
Yes, I'm sorry. Hi, Mithat. Thanks for a very nice talk.
How are you?
Yeah, how are you? Yeah. So I have a very simple question just to understand better. So when you said in the first part of the talk, you said the deformed Young males, you have SN Higgs.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at this expectation value Polyakov line, it seems that this Polyakov line is actually symmetric respect to permutations.
Oh, very good. Actually, let me make that statement much more precise. So in deformed Young males on R3 cross S1, so the deformation guarantees that at small circle, center symmetry is stable. So if you look to the Polyakov line, okay, wrapping the S1 circle, the eigenvalues are exactly uniformly distributed. There is one eigenvalue at the root of unity, another eigenvalue, you know, uniformly separated from it, filling the whole circle. That thing actually, that choice of the background wave breaks, it respects center symmetry. And there is something interesting there. It actually respects Zn cyclic subgroup of the Sn permutation. Because of that, actually, I was a little bit unfair to deform Young males and QCD adjoint. Actually, in these theories, if you look to fundamental string tension, there is also unique string tension exactly because of this feature. There is a remaining Zn cyclic shift symmetry. But in Polyakov and Cyber-Quitton, none of this is there. But here is the point. Go to charges associated with two index representation. For Polyakov and Cyber-Quitton, there are order n square tensions. In deformed Young males and QCD adjoint, there are n tensions because there is a Zn cyclic shift symmetry and it forces you to Zn orbits. Okay. But if you go to our semi-abelian theory, as well as pure Young males theory, there are only two tensions in the game. Okay, so order n square, order n to the zero, from bad to good. Yeah. So that background, as I said, that background of the Polyakov loop, center symmetric background, only respects the n cyclic shift symmetry, not the whole non-abelian structure. It's a good question.
Thanks, Mishat. Yeah, Mitat. Yeah.
Okay. I don't see any other questions from the audience. So I think I could use this opportunity to thank Mithat for a nice presentation. And with that, we will wrap this up.